So the title of our workshop, which is not going to be a presentation, the workshop is Rebuilding Japan in the Aftermath of the Earthquake and Tsunami. Allow me to show a few visual images about what followed during the first 10 days of this disaster. Simply a few photos. All these communities which are hit by the tsunami are Asian communities. Self-defense force. Temporary shelter, like school, gyms. Temporary bath. Coffins. And people paying tribute to those who perished. Let me basically lay out what I want to do together with you today. That just a couple of sentences about the background of why I invited you to this community discussion. First and foremost, I did a field work in northern part of Japan called the Iwate Prefecture about a month ago. And I was able to go to the three of the hardest hit areas, towns or cities of Iwate Prefecture. It's an area called Rikuzen Takata and Kamaishi. And Otsuji. I get back to these places in a moment. The international image 7 months after this disaster is Fukushima, Fukushima, and Fukushima, with nuclear issue being so influential, capturing so much of attention nationwide as well as internationally. Many of the disaster-struck areas which have little to do with the nuclear disaster are being forgotten 7 months into the post-disaster. And that disaster that is kept intact is as serious as the nuclear reactor question. And I thought there is a value of reviving that point, for it's going to be many years, if not decades, of reconstruction to come. And I also want to emphasize that because it is already 7 to 8 months after disaster, many people don't really see BBC or CNN news about Japan in terms of the disaster. And yes, the situation is as dire as ever, with the winter coming, which is the coldest winter you could ever imagine in Japan, in northern part. So it is that broader background that actually inspired me to do a little bit of a community event. And I have three concrete objectives I want to achieve. Number one, how many of you have either lived or visited Japan? Okay. How many of you are planning to go to Japan or want to go to Japan? And that could include, virtually, everybody. So those of you who choose to work in Japan or who continue to be engaged in Japan, either as language teachers in whatever capacity, this is equivalent to September 11th. It is very important to know something about March 11th in a Japanese context. Everything is influenced or even defined by March 11th as of today in Japan, without the slightest exaggeration, including the nuclear question. The second objective I want to achieve together with you has to do with a question: how many of you have worked in disaster-struck areas, natural disasters, have lived or worked? How many of you plan to work in disaster-struck areas in terms of your future aspirations? Okay. There are so many lessons to be learned from the Japanese case. And prior to going to the field, I was actually working in the disaster struck area of Pakistan. And then I was struck by the disaster in my home country that really shocked me. But I was really struck by so many similarities, as well as differences, between the Pakistan floods and the Japanese tsunami and the earthquake. So I'm hoping that even if you choose not to work in Japan, you may learn some lessons. And the third, an equally important objective. As I've held a number of community meetings in northern part of Japan, I was told numerous times that the largest fear that people have in those communities is that they are going to be forgotten. Immediately after the disaster, so many charity organizations, so many donations, I think some of you might have donated. But now, 7 months afterwards, with the competing world news elsewhere, from Sudan to Somalia to elsewhere, everywhere, Japan, especially the disaster shock area, is being forgotten. But the reconstruction, which may take years, is simply starting. At the very least, they are not necessarily seeking massive amount of material support. And after all, this is Japan. Yes, resource scarcity is there. But it is more of the fact that people still remember them. People care about them. And I was told that that has to give them tremendous strength. For those communities with resilience have the motivation to demonstrate to the society that they can perhaps contribute to inspiring other people who are in some challenging circumstances. So I made a sacred promise to the community members that when I return to the US, I'll do a series of sessions. So by virtue of holding this session, I'm keeping my promise. It would be nice if you could be part of my aspiration to keep the promise. And I witness a portion of their challenges as well as resilience that hopefully inspired you. All right? So that's the basic outline of what I want to do. Now, get to some specifics. First, the basic geography and basic facts here. You see the epicenter of the earthquake, I'll be very brief on this. Miyagi Prefecture, which includes Sendai. Anybody who has been to Sendai, which is a very major city? Yeah? And north of that is going to be Iwate Prefecture, which I reproduced here. Okay. So this red circle is the hardest hit area in terms of earthquake, with implications for the size of the tsunamis that came. A few facts about this earthquake and the tsunami. Magnitude around 9.0. The high waves, the height of, I meant to say, height of waves, 10 to 40 meters. You know what 40 meters could possibly mean in the American standard?
It's like 40
meters. Yeah. Maybe 10-story building of some sort. Yeah. And there are four waves that came, the second wave being the biggest. In some areas, the first wave actually receded back into the ocean. That created a massive collision between that wave coming back to the ocean, another wave coming. And it created a huge mountain of wave. Local people described the second wave, which was about, in some areas, 33 meters or even close to 40, as a black wall instead of a wave. Death and missing about 20,000 people, displaced population 40,000, and many more perhaps. Houses demolished, including partial demolition, 270,000. What do you make out of these statistics? How do you describe it in a nutshell, in terms of its impact? Especially for those communities which are sparsely populated. So the three areas that I looked at, all of them in Iwate Prefecture, represent Takata. The population is about, this is very approximate, 20,000 after this disaster. People who died or who are missing, about 2,200. So what's the ratio of the population who either died or still missing compared to the total population?
12%.
Kamaishi City, which is larger, with a long tradition of steel products making, 37,000 people as a total population, 1,300 people died or still missing. Otsuchi area, 13,000, out of 13,000 people, 1,700 people either died or are missing. Now we continue to say missing because the families want to honor the fact that they are missing, which is very important, right? And the reason I want to make it more of a dialogue or workshop is that I could easily talk for an hour and a half, but that could be boring, even if the subject is quite important. So I will turn to you, and in a truly SIT-ish experiential way, I would invite you to think of doing some sort of a preliminary field work, a needs assessment. In a moment, you see a fisherman coming to this room, and he will take your questions. In a moment, somebody from in a temporary shelter will come to this room, take a couple of your questions. And also, somebody from the city council will come to you and take a couple of questions. As you do a little bit, that could be me, but in all three cases. You know that taxi way, those of you who are in my classes. So, there are two questions I want to ask. One is, how do you describe, based on all of that exploratory process, how do you describe the needs and priorities of these communities for reconstruction? The second question is, based on that preliminary needs analysis, what are some of the policy measures and civil society initiatives to meet the needs and the priorities? Now, you're not going to get this, of course, within the next hour or so, but the speed is to really be experiential and start thinking about it. Yeah? The way of thinking perhaps invites some insights. The ship's wrecked, house is demolished. Okay. So let me then invite you to these communities and show you a few audio-visual images that I captured. So the first one is the Otsuchi, this area called Otsuchi, which was not only devastated by the tsunami, but also by the fire. So be ready to start answering the questions I pose.
In this area, faced multiple tsunami waves, and then followed up by the large fire that spread. And this entire area used to be inhabited, and there used to be a number of houses. But now there is virtually nothing, as far as I can see. It really would take if there is a will to reduce it.
Okay, so this is one area of devastation. I think this is very slow to do. Right. Now, as you walk into a place like Rikuzen Takata, and there is a big, very fine hospital, which is completely gutted. What would it look like?
October 10th, 2011. I am standing in front of the ruins of the Rikuzen Takada-based Atomic Hospital, which was devastated by the floods. And it is said that the second out of the four waves that came was as high as 33 meters. And then this hospital was completely wiped out the people inside virtually all dead, and the devastation is total. And this is the outside of the hospital. And as we come outside, the entire area here, this was not a plain. This was a relatively well inhabited residential area. But now there stands nothing. And the debris which are piled up are still to be cleaned up. And the town was wiped out. There used to be so many houses.
So this is example of one building, which happens to be a hospital. Now, let me then invite you to meet with a fisherman. You're not going to see a fisherman except myself pretending to be a fisherman. But this is a part of the reality that the fisherman may be facing.
October 12, 2001, I am standing at the seashore of the Rikugen Sakana City. And this is the ocean that the city is about. Now there is a removal of the debris and the reconstruction that's going on. The ocean that I am looking at now, the water just in front of me, this particular area that is extended to a little bit of a mountain area that we see in front of us. It was not under the water, and now because of the disaster, the seawater actually came into what used to be the land. So this entire land, this entire water got submerged and remained submerged 7 months after the tsunami. This vast area remains submerged under the snow.
Okay. So from Rikusen Takara, there is a representative of a fishing industry that came to greet you. And you can ask any questions, but the two questions I posed to you, how do you actually describe the most salient urgent needs and priorities in the communities? And then what can we do about it? So suppose there is somebody who knows a lot about fishing industry in these areas. What questions do you need to ask the fishing industry representative to begin to understand the needs? Go ahead.
Are the fish healthy?
The fish is healthy, but the seedbed is completely destroyed. So for the areas where we have been farming the fish, the whole basis has been destroyed. Any other questions you want to ask the fishing industry representative? While I do that, I'm actually reflecting on everything I learned from the fishing industry. Try. This is SIT.
Are they wildly caught fish or are they farm-raised fish?
Both. So for seaweeds and for other products that we are so proud of, we have a farming technique, the oysters as well. But I think there is tremendous abundance and diversity of seafood, you know, the shellfish and also fish that are wild, that appears to be in not unlimited supply, a tremendous supply for which we are very famous. Yes?
How many ships are missing?
How many ships? Virtually, you can imagine all the ships got destroyed. I said all the ships. So imagine a community that had 200 ships of a sizable, you know, dimension. One or two, or maybe up to five, by Mir Kosova. So what shall we do? We look for the people who are the owners of those surviving ships. We make a temporary collectivity, and we use that single ship. We do the labor together. We divide the revenues, which is very marginal. So for much of the time, what we do is to be employed in the debris clearance, which is funded by the public money. But this clearance of debris is going to last forever. However, the money that is available to pay us is going to be limited. So maybe for the next month or two, maybe for the next month, it's going to be depleted. Fishermen being unemployed, so miserable. What other questions do you want to ask?
Did you have insurance on the boats?
Oh, that's a wonderful question. We are small fishermen, many of them. There are some big fishermen, but great majority of us are small fishermen. So we have, in a sense, association that enables, that helps us whenever there is damage. Now, with the devastation of so many ships of this scale, it's only the country, the government, that can help. So the government, after the devastation, immediately provided, instituted the policy that actually paid for certain portion of the money that's used to purchase new ships, either through a fishing association or on an individual basis. But I think there is much more of a collectivization taking place in the sense of fishing industry. Each one of the towns played such a huge role in receiving the fund from the government and distributing it among the fishermen. Now, here is a tricky part. Even if I am able to start purchasing a ship, number one, we don't know exactly when the ship is going to be built. There's a big, big line of people waiting for their ships. Number two, it is not only the ships that are needed to start fishing. You need other instruments that go with the fish ships. They're going to be very expensive. How do I get money when I don't have any revenue? Right? So the market is not only about regaining ships. It's the totality of the infrastructure that I need. Let me shift then my attention to some other people. I'll invite you to a temporary shelter. And there are dozens of temporary shelter, premises of temporary shelter throughout each one of those places. But this is one of them.
October 11, 2011, I'm at the temporary shelter of the internally displaced people for the Kamaishi city. So it's a very densely populated area with little privacy, and then there is garbage collection that's going on there.
Okay. Now, having lived in post inside Rwanda and having worked in post conflict zones, yes, this is a little bit different from some of the places, right? But still, it's a temporary shelter with its own problems. Suppose you have a representative of one of the temporary shelter units, and you can talk to that person, he or she, really to understand some of the needs which may not be so visible. Please ask good questions.
Are the residents of your shelter able to work?
Now, first of all, there's no work to speak of. Think of it. We became homeless and shelterless because we live very close to the ocean, right? And that's where the tsunami struck. So what kind of occupation do you think we are in? Typically.
Fishing.
Yeah, fishing being a huge industry. And the people who are displaced tend to be associated with fishing. These units, these housing units are built a little bit of a mountain area, instead of being close to the ocean. So even if I can find somebody who has a ship, and we can collaborate for the time being, it's so far away from the ocean. Fishermen away from the ocean, that's no good. So in addition to having no work, or little worship, apart from clearing debris. I think that the whole infrastructure of life as fishermen has been uprooted. Any other questions?
Has safety been a concern?
Now, this is a good thing about perhaps, not a good thing, but you know, this is Japan. There's no, for example, terrorism or anything, unlike in some other places that I'm working in, as you know, in my class. No, that's struck by the disaster. So there is no vandalism or anything, except on the very rare cases in the shelter units. However, as I mentioned, there are so many people who are aging. Their spouses have been killed in the disaster. Think of a 70-year-old, a 65-year-old lady or gentleman who lost his or her spouse, living in his pigeonhole for 3 months, 4 months. There is an increase in the number of people who commit suicide in those temporary units. That is a plain fact. With the winter coming, it is very unlikely to suspect that the number of people who commit suicide will decrease.
Do you have space for everyone?
Do we have space for everyone?
Yeah, everyone without housing.
Absolutely no. But I think the government, both the national government and the municipal government, did their very best to build as many of those units as possible within the first 3 to 4 months of the disaster, such that a good majority of the people who wanted to be accommodated were accommodated. But those who wanted to stay with their relatives and family members far away, they're doing it.
The senior citizens that are there, are all their healthcare needs met?
The hospitals being destroyed, healthcare support system being destroyed. But much more importantly, in these rural areas, there is a system called BRAKU. BRAKU is a community-based support system that is very unique to the Japanese system. So either for any vicissitudes of life, marriage, funeral, and health related matters, as well as fishing, agriculture, those BRAKU units really support each other. So apart from the formal structure of health provision being destroyed, the informal networks that have been the lifeline of those people have been destroyed. Now, people who live in these areas got scattered from the natural, actually, terrains where the BRAKU communities existed. So between the neighbors, they haven't communicated ever since they moved in, like 4 or 5 months ago. That enhances increases the sense of isolation. Let me then shift our attention to the next scene. Okay. Then you'll be talking to somebody from the city council or one of the places. Let me pick Rikuzen Takara. This is a city council building.
October 10th, 2011, I am inside a building, devastated building of the municipal office of representative of the city, Iwate Prefecture. As we can see, the devastation is quite complete. Inside this building, a couple of cars, and lots of textbooks of small children, and all the debris are still inside. I think it is my personal impression that this resembles a war zone, some sort of the aftermath of a complete devastation.
In front of each one of the city council buildings, there is this ceremonious place where people can offer flowers and things of that nature.
Okay. So you get to see a representative of a city council in one of the three places, because I showed representative Tagada, you know, inspired to me. Please ask good questions for his assessment. What are some initial questions you want to ask? You see a mayor. Yes.
What is being done to prepare for the winter?
The first thing that the city did, one of the first things, was to create a temporary shelter unit for a temporary city council, municipal office to be built. Because it becomes a hub of all information about preparation for winter, and then et cetera, being in touch with Tokyo to continue to have temporary, you know, relief supplies to survive in winter. But apart from that, the number one priority that is still to be done is to clear the debris. So long as those things are sitting, we won't be able to do much. Because those debris do occupy the land where we can do all the preparation, either for winter, for anything. Any other questions? Yes.
Can I ask, within the region or the country, what do you have in terms of materials or competence? What is available to me?
Now, I like that question so much. Because depending upon where you go, the answer is going to be completely different. Number one, each one of the prefectures, not prefectures, but municipalities, has a declining population, which means declining tax revenue base. So we don't have so much of a pile of revenues to dispose of to start with. First is the devastation. So even to actually collect the bodies of the deceased and send them for cremation, do we have enough resources and capacity? The answer, unfortunately, is no. In some of those municipalities, people send so many dead bodies to Tokyo or elsewhere in the Kanto area for collective cremation, which creates so much traumatization. Secondly, that coordination with Tokyo has been so frustrating. For example, clearing the debris. So we made a number of requests to Tokyo, and there is a red tape and there are some regulations that would not allow them and us to process the debris as quickly as we want. We even thought of outsourcing foreign companies, foreign countries, to clear the debris, or to have a temporary incinerator that burns those things that stay. That has not been done. So if you ask about the resources being available, we don't have much, and so much of the resources has to do with ingenuity, how we think, how we negotiate. So one of those cities, in particular, Tagada, even created intercity forum to actually seek support from the municipalities way outside the Tohoku northern part, and that expanded the resources. So that's why what I refer to as ingenuity or intangible resource. Lots of things have been negotiated. What other questions do you want to ask to a city representative?
What percentage of the survivors have the opportunity to relocate? And what percentage of the survivors have the skills to pursue a new career other than fishing?
Now, what percentage of survivors,
family in the West.
Outside.
How many people have the opportunity to leave or
leave the town
or go to the West or something?
I suspect that people, even the city council people, won't have the exact statistics. But the obvious trend that emerges from the conversations is that people with younger kids, people who are still young, in their 30s, early 40s, having a long-term career aspiration, do not see immediate future in their hometowns, with the industry devastated, right? So they are likely to go to Tokyo, at least to Sendai. And then that even accelerates the number of people who leave the towns. So So the challenge becomes for the city planners point of view is, how can we create, how can we do a city planning that is attractive for the next generation? So that those people who actually leave temporarily can come back or want to come back. So that's a major challenge. So I'm not able to answer your question in terms of the exact statistics. But I think the local people also tell me, including the city people also tell me, that youth who grow up tend to have a rather local view about the world. And the encounters with foreigners or people who are outside their prefecture can be more scarce, more rare than, let's say, Tokyo or Sendai and other places. So those are some of the narratives that you hear very often, with some implications, perhaps, for the future reconstruction. I'll take one more. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Are they talking about changing, because the fishing industry is not necessarily sustainable. Mm-hmm. So are people talking about changing what they do for a living instead of fishing? Mm-hmm. Or is it just so ingrained in the culture for generations that that's what we do, we fish?
So back to a fisherman, right?
Yeah.
The overwhelming emphasis among people in the fishing industry is that they are so proud of being fishermen. They're not going to leave the fishing industry, especially if it is a transgenerational commitment. And the word out there basically is that the more you invest in the sea, the more revenue you get. Yeah. Unlike being a salaried person, you have the complete freedom in terms of hours of work. Plus, how much of additional kinds of fishing you do. Seaweed, oysters, different kinds of fish. It really depends on your ingenuity and effort. So we like fishing. That's the kind of answer that repeatedly comes up. So I accept that this is never sufficient, even to start brainstorming possible answers to those questions.